Good afternoon. Thank you all for coming to the SETI Talks for today. Our speaker is Phil Nicholson. Phil was educated at the University of Queensland and then at Caltech, where he worked with the great Peter Goldreich. And from there, he's gone on to spend 35 years and counting as a professor at Cornell University, where he works on solar system dynamics of all kinds, including planetary rings, which is our topic for today. On a personal note, Phil has been one of the primary mentors of my scientific career, and I'm grateful for his personal generosity as well as his qualities as a mathematical dynamicist and as a scientist. Phil is a science team member for the Visual and Infrared Mapping Spectrometer instrument on board the Cassini spacecraft, and he is here today to talk to us about stellar occultations of planetary rings from Palomar to Cassini. So let's welcome Phil Nicholson.
Thank you, Matt.
Do I sound like I'm on live? Yes. Okay, good. I have a quiet voice. Okay, so thank you very much for your welcome here. And I don't think Matt mentioned at the beginning, I'm here visiting on sabbatical this year. So I'm beginning of a two-month period at NASA Ames. So if you want to chat about things, those of you that work here, I'll be there and over at SETI intermittently over the next 2 months. So I'll be around. So the talk today is going to be a sort of a combination of a little bit of ancient history. This particular slide is from 1985, so it's over 30 years old now. But most of it will be dealing with recent observations we've made with Cassini over the last 10 years. But I wanted to set a little bit of the historical scene. And this will be sort of a personal talk in the sense that I'm just going to shamelessly advertise and talk about the work that I was directly involved in rather than attempt to sort of summarize the whole field and give equal time to everybody. Also, I'm only going to talk about planetary rings. Those of you that know something about stellar occultations know that the technique is used for many other purposes, initially used to study planetary atmospheres. And that's really a whole different talk with a different set of physical problems and theories and such. So I decided rather than to try to confuse things by mixing them all together, just to concentrate on using occultations to study the rings, which is what I personally do in my research. So that being said, I do have to at least mention one other very important work that was the sort of start of this whole business. And that was the discovery of the uranian rings. And this actually is an occultation profile of the uranian rings. It's not the discovery observation. It was one that we did at Palomar about 8 years later. But the idea is the same. And this was observed in March 1977. It was done by a couple of ground-based observatories, but in particular by the KAO, the Kuiper Airborne Observatory, which is still parked somewhat forlornly down on the ramp at Ames, hidden behind a warehouse or something down there, but I notice it is still there. And the PI of the observation was Jim Elliott, who was a young professor at Cornell at the time. He was trying to study the atmosphere of Uranus, which had never been studied before, by observing a star go behind the planet, which he did successfully. But in the process, he discovered that there were a set of narrow rings around the planet, which had previously been completely unexpected. So that was sort of the beginning of realizing that occultations might be a powerful way to study not only atmospheres, but to study rings, especially narrow rings that could not be easily imaged. But I want to step back just for a moment to some really ancient history, because the idea of looking at something going behind the rings as a way of probing the rings actually has an older history than doing occultations. And this actually is an observation that we did at Mount Palomar in January 1978. And actually, it's not an occultation, it's an eclipse. It's an observation of Saturn's satellite Iapetus. And once every 15 years, as Saturn moves around the sun, the geometry is such that the sun shines through the rings onto the surface of Iapetus. And Iapetus is partly eclipsed. If you were standing on Iapetus, you would see the sun disappear behind the rings. So we did an observation of this, and the little open circles there are measurements of the brightness of Iapetus relative to Titan as a function of time. And this is the 2 microns, so we're looking at reflected sunlight. And what you're seeing here, remember I have a pointer, is the star, the sun is emerging from the B ring, the most opaque part of Saturn's rings, that basically no sunlight comes through. It shines briefly through the Cassini division, the gap between the A and B rings. The sun goes behind the A ring for a while, and at this point, the sun pops out from behind the edge of the A-ring and fully shines on Iapetus. And we did this measurement because we wanted to measure the thermal properties of Iapetus. So the solid circles show measurements done at the same time with a 20-micron photometer to measure the thermal emission. So the physically interesting thing here was the delay in the 20-micron signal compared to the 2-micron, and this reflects the thermal inertia of Iapetus' surface, how fluffy, and does indeed turn out to have a very fluffy, low-density surface, long thermal time constant. The interesting thing here is that a very similar observation was done in 1889. Again, not very far from here. It was done up at the Lick Observatory by the astronomer E.E. Barnard, who later on went to Yerkes and became famous, but he worked up here. He did a very similar observation in 89, except he watched by eye Iapetus changing brightness as the sun, as solar illumination varied. And from this, he concluded, in his case, the sun was moving behind the C ring, the inner ring of Saturn. And he concluded for a first time a rough estimate of the optical depth or the transparency through the C ring. So he made a semi-quantitative estimate, but based on just using his eye to measure the brightness. So there's a somewhat longer history of using probes behind the rings to study the rings, especially their optical depth or their degree of transparency. So back to the 1977 and the discovery of the uranian rings. We many of us got interested as soon as rings were discovered around Uranus. I was a grad student at Caltech at the time. At that point, only Saturn was thought to have rings, and a lot of people had spent time trying to explain why Saturn was unique. Suddenly, Uranus had rings. It had this set of five obvious narrow rings, and then it turned out there were three more that weren't so obvious once they looked more closely. But one of the most intriguing things that turned up immediately was that the broadest of the rings, which got called the Epsilon ring, was apparently variable in width. In this particular case, it was 99 kilometers wide. So this actually is a tracing, actually photographed from an actual paper strip chart, of the brightness of the star as it went behind the Epsilon ring. And a later occultation that we did down in Chile next year, 1978, showed the same ring, but only 70 kilometers wide. Also, the radius of the ring appeared to be different in the two. And for a while, there was a thought that maybe Uranus had incomplete rings, several rings at different radii. But after we'd collected a few more occultations, we realized that you could plot up the width of the ring here, and it varied from about 20 to about 100 kilometers. So this turned out to be about the widest the ring ever gets. If you plot the width versus the radius, the distance from the center of Uranus, there is a nice straight line relationship between these. So it's clearly all the same ring. And in fact, you get this geometry if you have a ring that has, instead of circular edges, elliptical edges. And if the ellipticity or eccentricity of the outer edge is a little more than the one of the inner edge, then you get this nice linear trend. So it was a very nice indication that this is, in fact, an eccentric ring. So not only was this the first ring system discovered since Saturn, it was the first ring that was ever suspected to be non-circular. We now know, as you'll see later in the talk, that that's pretty common, even at Saturn, if you have high accuracy measurements. But this was a real sort of, I wouldn't say earth-shaking, but to those of us who worked in planetary ring dynamics, this was an earth-shaking problem. So this is the same slide I showed you on the introduction. We continue to do more of these stellar occultations. This is probably one of the best ones we've ever done. This was done from the Palomar Hale telescope, the 5-meter telescope, with a high-speed indium antimonide photometer with about 10-millisecond sample time. These were simple instruments that didn't take images. They just measured the brightness of the star. Their advantage is that you could run them much faster than you could run a camera even today. So for this purpose, timing is all important, and rapid collection of data is important because each of these rings are very sharp. They're not even resolved at this scale. So this is just the flux from the star. So this is what the star looks like when it's not behind the rings. And then these rapid dips represent the rings. This is as the star was approaching Uranus, the so-called ingress half of the occultation, coming this way actually in time. This is plotted versus radius, but in time it came this way. The star then goes behind the planet for an hour or so, comes out from behind the planet, and then goes out and goes behind the rings again on the other side. So this is the egress, the exit half of the occultation. And it's pretty easy to see that you see the same rings on both sides. They line up, but you can see the Epsilon ring is a different radii and particularly different widths at the two locations. Well, by the time we fortunately, there was the Voyager spacecraft had flown by Saturn and was en route to Uranus. It was already known that it was going to be going there. By the time of the mid-80s, once we had sort of figured out the geometry of the eccentricity of this ring, and it turned out that some of the other rings were eccentric too, if you plop them carefully, but not as much as this one, we had a pretty good model by the time the Voyager spacecraft was programmed to fly by Uranus in 1986, so it was rather fortuitous. So this was from a review chapter that Jim Elliott and I wrote at the time describing the geometry of the rings. Here's the planet, here's the eight rings, and here's the epsilon ring with a break to sort of remind people that it's eccentric. Here's just a diagram blown up to show this better to scale. And this is a cartoon. So each of these, this represents the epsilon ring sort of to scale, but the width scale, the scale across here, compared to the radial scale, the width scale has been exaggerated by a factor of 100. So the real ring, the width is sort of shown over here. Basically, you wouldn't see it on this scale. So I've blown up the width by 100. And each of these bars represents an individual occultation observation that we had done. Most of these were done before Voyager. And then I've added later on, this one actually was a measurement done by Voyager itself, as was this one. So Voyager itself did a couple of occultation measurements as well. So this was a pretty good picture we had of the rings, but we'd never actually seen them before Voyager got there in any real sense. So it took Voyager to actually take real images. So this is a montage of a couple of Voyager images showing the narrow rings, and the labeling is a bit strange. Mentioned that before, but they have this rather weird historical labeling system. The first five that were discovered were labeled sensibly enough alpha, beta, gamma, delta, and epsilon, but then later on somebody discovered 4, 5, and 6, and then there was an eta that was discovered, and the standard convention in astronomy is to name things in order of discovery rather than necessarily geometry, and the names of the discoverers tend to get perpetuated once they're published. So even though it would be sensible to redo all of these names, it's never been done. So here they are. Here's the three inner rings, 6, 5, and 4. Alpha, beta, gamma, delta. Here's the eta ring. You can see why it was harder to see than the others. And then here is the wider eccentric epsilon ring. Nowadays, you can actually see these with a telescope from the ground, which we couldn't back then. This is an exquisite image taken by Imke Depata at UC Berkeley. This is taken using the 10-meter Keck telescope and their adaptive optics system. So it's a near-infrared 2.1 micron image. Here's a, I think this is Miranda, one of the satellites used as a reference object for the AO system here. Here is Uranus itself looking very faint because this wavelength is a strong methane absorption band in the planet's atmosphere. And you can see the rings. You can see the epsilon ring is the bright one, and then you can see the pair, delta gamma up here, and then the double alpha beta just barely, and then the inner three are sort of merged together. So this is probably the best image that's ever been taken from the ground that just barely actually shows all the rings. So enough for Uranus, but what this did show us is that ring systems could be more complicated than we first thought. You could have narrow rings as well as the broad rings of Saturn, and you could have eccentric rings like the epsilon ring. Well, astronomers, not being complete idiots, said, well, maybe nobody's ever looked at Neptune. Maybe we should do a stellar occultation of Neptune and see if there's something lurking there that you can't see. So in the early 80s, people started hunting for occultations. And in 1984, the first successful occultation was done. This one actually was done the next year in 1985. This was one again. This one actually we did it at the IRTF, the NASA's Infrared Telescope Facility in Hawaii on Mauna Kea. And it's again a measurement of the brightness of the star at a wavelength of 2 microns, K-band, as a function of time. So it's over a 4-hour period. This is where the star disappeared behind Neptune itself. So now I'm showing you the whole occultation. These were just a couple of checks where the observer was feeling nervous and wanted to make sure the star was still sitting in the aperture. So he flipped the little mirror out just to have a look with his eye. Fortunately, he did it at the right time. And then just a little, nothing was seen on ingress. So these were both instrumental checks. But on egress, just after the star came out from behind the planet, just here, there was a little dip. And here it is blown up. And it was a bit over a second wide. The signal only dropped about 20%, so not nearly as opaque as the epsilon ring, but translates into a width of something like 15 kilometers, so not as wide as the epsilon ring. The nice thing is that it turned out this same occultation was observed on another telescope on the same mountaintop, and the same dip was seen. That made it much more likely that this was a real feature and not some strange gremlin in the telescope electronics. It also confirmed nicely the actual observation done in 1984 by Hubbard and Brahek, where they had got a very similar observation from Chile. So this seemed to confirm it. The puzzling thing is that if this was a circular ring, or even a slightly eccentric one, it should have been visible over here somewhere too. So we really couldn't make sense of it. This was a diagram I made at the time that shows Neptune, a couple of hypothetical rings in Neptune's equatorial plane, and then these lines indicate the tracks that various stars had been observed to follow behind Neptune. The one with the big red arrow is the one I just showed you. And that occultation track is this one labeled 4. And if this was a nice circular ring, we should have captured it over here on the ingress side, but we did not. And the same is true. I think this was the original discovery one that was seen over here, but not seen again over here. So we had a couple of occultations where we saw a ring on one side of Neptune, not the others. And I haven't showed you the other half a dozen occultations that we or other people had tried that showed nothing at all. So again, Voyager to the rescue. Fortunately, Voyager went on from Uranus to fly by Neptune in 1989. And one of the things the Voyager scientists had learned was that a good way of seeing faint rings is to have the spacecraft fly into the shadow behind the planet so that the sun was blocked, and then look back towards the sun, so look at high phase angle to see light forward scattered. And that's a good geometry to see fine dust particles. So it doesn't help if the ring is made of Volkswagen-sized rocks, which the Uranian rings are, or Saturn's rings. But if the ring is made of fine dust, like the Jovian ring, which had been discovered in the same way, then it shows up beautifully. So indeed, it turned out that Neptune has two rings. Here's a crescent of Neptune down here. The spacecraft is on the other side of Neptune from the sun, looking back to the sun. And here are the two rings, now known as the Adams ring and the Le Verrier ring, after the two theoreticians who discovered, in quotes, Neptune from predicted it from perturbations of Uranus. But the striking thing is this. The arcs, the features that we had seen all turned out to be attributable to the Adams ring, but it turned out that there were three and actually four bright clumps within the Adams ring that are about 10 times brighter than the rest of the ring, and therefore we assume about 10 times more opaque. And it turned out that whenever one of our occultations went through one of those arcs, so here's a diagram showing the longitudes of the three main arcs and then the fainter one that was seen in the Voyager images. And then we don't know exactly the rate at which these arcs are orbiting the planet, but we know from Kepler's third law we can calculate approximately what the rate should be. So we know they should have been moving at around 820 degrees per day, or a period a little bit less than 12 hours. And each of these solid lines on here represents one of these occultations that happened to cut the arcs. So we just sort of played the geometry game of what if you adjust this rate of motion of the arcs. You know when you did the occultations, they were typically done 4 or 5 years before Voyager got there, so you extrapolate the arc forwards. So you try to line things up, you try to find periods or mean motions, angular rates, such that these lines intersect the arcs that Voyager observed. And then you have these dotted ones, which are occultations we did that did not show any kind of an arc. So you want to make sure that the dotted lines don't cross the arc. And it turned out when you did this that there were two possible solutions, only two solutions that worked. If the mean motion was about 820.119, then you could line up these ones nicely with the arcs and these other ones miss, or about 820.112, you could line up. The nice thing is that in the meantime, Carol and Porco on the imaging team and Peter Goldreich, who was her advisor and also, as Matt mentioned, had been my advisor at Caltech, they come up with a very elegant theoretical model to explain arcs within rings that involved resonances with nearby satellites. So they hypothesized, A, that a nearby satellite must exist close to the rings. And based on that model, and then actually Voyager went ahead and not only did it discover the arcs, it actually found that this little satellite was there, not in quite the place they predicted, but indeed there was a little satellite called Galatea close to the Neptunian ring. So based on that, they predicted a particular resonance that would explain the arcs. And they said, whoops. They said, if the mean motion is this red value here, then we've hit the jackpot. This is the resonant value calculated from the orbital period of Galatea. And it looked pretty close. So it looked reasonable, but science isn't always reasonable. So it turns out that we didn't get any more occultations of the Neptune rings. Neptune moved away from the galactic plane, and it became very poor pickings for occultations. But eventually, the ground-based telescopes caught up. And in this case, it was the Hubble Space Telescope caught up. and made it possible to actually take images. So this is one of Mark Showalter's images of the Neptune images being stuck in here for artistic purposes. It would have been a long exposure originally. But you see some noise around here. But faintly, you can see the Laveria ring and the Adams ring. And you follow the Adams ring around. Lo and behold, here are the arcs. Two of them are at least a nice, still obvious in brightness. And I think you could see the third, or? The third is gone, OK. So this was in 2004. So we're now talking about 15 years after Voyager. And the only problem was that we were now able to measure the mean motion of the arcs quite accurately, because we now had a more than 20-year baseline from when they had first been discovered. And it turns out that the rate is 820.112 degrees per day, which turns out to be right on top of this one. So I was happy because one of my two predictions worked out in the end. Carol and Peter were not so happy because the resonant model didn't work. So the way science goes. Anyway, so that was sort of by way of background. That's how I got sort of started in this business. But it also serves, I think, to show you some of the interplay between doing occultation measurements, which can give you very precise geometry, high resolution to measure widths of narrow rings, and can measure the radii of features accurate to a kilometer or so. So much more accurately than you can do with images, at least images taken with a ground-based telescope. So there's an interplay between the dynamics and the structure of the rings and doing these occultation observations. But occultations are limited from the ground. You're basically at the mercy of God or the heavens to put the planet in front of an appropriately bright star. And this doesn't happen very often. We were lucky in the mid-1980s, both Uranus and Neptune moved across the galactic plane, and there was a high density of occultations. You could do two or three every year for both planets. But by the end of the 80s, that had stopped. The planets had moved on to a much more barren area of the sky. And now there is maybe one occultation every 5 or 10 years or so that's bright enough to be observable. So it's hard to keep doing these and collect much more data if you're restricted to occultations you can see from the ground. But it turns out you can do lots of wonderful things if you have a spacecraft in orbit around a planet. So obviously, you can take much better images, spectra, other things. So this is a spectral image of Saturn taken by the VIMS instrument on Cassini, the Infrared Mapping Spectrometer, which is the instrument that I work on. But my interest here is not taking images like this, but actually using the instruments on Cassini to do occultations themselves. And when you're close to the planet in orbit around it, the rings subtend a huge area on the sky. Compared to the Uranian rings subtend an angle of about 8 arc seconds on the sky seen from the Earth, and the Neptune rings about half that. Whereas when you're sitting on Cassini looking at Saturn's rings, most of the time it's filling 30 or 40 degrees on the sky. So there are many opportunities for bright stars to go behind the rings or the planet. Now, we can't carry along a 5-meter telescope to do the observations, but if you can deal with first and second magnitude stars, then a little teeny telescope or a photometer will still work just as well. So this was just a quick couple of slides on Cassini, which most of you, I think, probably know something about already. It was launched in 97, went on this complicated trip through the solar system doing gravity assists at Venus and Earth, and eventually Jupiter, and eventually got to Saturn in July 2004, where we fired our main engine and put us into orbit around Saturn. Since then, we've done over 250 orbits around Saturn in the succeeding almost 13 years, and the mission is due to end in the next 6 months. This is actually the spacecraft itself with a couple of people for scale here. This is the main communications antenna. So this is used to send data back to the Earth. So this is one of the instruments that's used to do occultations. In fact, occultations are done with three different instruments on Cassini, although I'm just going to talk about one of them here. The radio science system uses that communication beam to send radio waves back through the rings. That lets us probe the transparency of the rings at microwave wavelengths, actually 1, 3, and 13 centimeters. So we get multi-wavelength data. That's very good for learning about the sizes of the particles and a bit about the way they're packed in the rings, but also the structure. But two sort of, quotes, optical instruments. The ultraviolet imaging spectrometer does stellar occultations working down in the ultraviolet, 100 to 300 nanometers. And the visual and infrared mapping spectrometer, the VIMS instrument that I work on, does stellar and solar occultations in the near infrared from 1 to 5 microns, the same wavelengths we've used from the ground typically. This is an example of a radio occultation of Saturn's rings. This particular one was done by Voyager. Voyager did the same experiment using its communications beam. So this is a measure of the optical depth of the ring. And the optical depth, for those of you that aren't astronomers that do this, is just to find that if you have an incident beam, either a star beam or in this case the signal beam, the transmitter beam coming from the spacecraft with intensity I0, goes through the rings, comes out the other side attenuated. The attenuation depends on two things, the optical depth of the ring, tau, which is plotted here, and the sine of the angle between the ring plane and the line of sight. This is just a geometric factor that says if you look vertically through the rings, there's less attenuation than if you look at a grazing angle. So this is just the intensity times e to the minus tau over sine b. So you measure this observed intensity, you know what b is, and you can back out tau, the optical depth of the ring. So this is tau at 3 centimeters from Voyager for the C ring. This is a Cassini mosaic of images across the ring. So this is the inner or C ring. This is the one that Barnard observed from Lick Observatory, was transparent. The B ring, which is pretty opaque. Again, you can see the optical depth is bigger than one. This is mostly noise. And then the A ring out here, and then the gap in between, the Cassini division, which turns out not to be just a gap, but a fairly complicated little subring of its own. So this is a radio measurement, but this is the equivalent measurement done in the infrared with VIMS, and the data I'm going to be showing you from now on all come from the VIMS instrument. So again, here is a mosaic of images of Saturn's rings taken by the camera system on Cassini. So again, the A ring is out here, the Cassini division, the B ring, and the C ring. This image looks a bit strange because it's an image on the dark side of the rings, not the lit side that you used to. So the B ring actually is not as bright as the A ring in this geometry, and the C ring is much brighter than you would normally expect. But again, and this is just plotted not in optical depth, but simply transmission, how much light comes through the rings. This is from the star Gamma Crucis. It's the red star at the top of the Southern Cross, for those of you that have been to the Southern Hemisphere. Done at a wavelength of 2.9 microns, and there's a little over 250,000 samples across here. We take a measurement, we actually take a spectrum every 20 milliseconds and turn that into the brightness of the star through the rings. This particular case, the resolution, the space between samples, is about 280 meters. That's, roughly speaking, 10 times better than the resolution of most Cassini images of the rings that are typically around 3 to 5 kilometers, although recently we've got some Cassini images that are as high as this. We can also observe the sun like a little bit like Barnard did originally in 1899. Barnard didn't look at the sun through the rings because from the Earth that's impossible to do. We can't be on the other side of Saturn. But he kind of indirectly looked at the sun going through the rings by looking at how the sun illuminated the satellite, the apatis. The spacecraft, on the other hand, can get onto the other side of Saturn and can look directly back through the rings at the sun and measure the transmission of sunlight. And you might say, why would you want to do this? And the main thing is signal to noise. The sun is almost infinitely brighter than a star. So even though we have to attenuate the instrument to stop it saturating, we still get, when we look at a typical stellar occultation, oh, there's no numbers on here, so we typically get a couple of 100 to 1,000 counts per sample. When we look at a solar occultation, we get more like 100,000 counts per sample. So the signal to noise is very good. The downside is that the sun is not a nice point source like a star. So when it shines through the rings, it averages over a chunk of the rings. And if you take the angular size of the sun at the typical distance that Cassini is from the rings when it does these experiments, it turns out the resolution is typically about 300 kilometers. So you see a much smoother version. In this particular case, the sun went behind the A ring. Here's the Cassini division, went behind the B ring, opaque. Went behind the C ring, but then never went behind the planet. It reached a minimum radius and then turned around and came back out again. So it went back out through the C ring, the B ring, the Cassini division, and the A ring, and back out. So you see two mirror image profiles. Most of the data I'm going to be showing you, though, is coming from the stellar occultations. So this was one of the first sets of occultations we did, and certainly the first one that showed us something that we had not expected to see. So this is a normally People show occultations as wiggly lines of transmission versus radius, so you'll see a bunch more of those. But sometimes it's nice to try to convert them to an imaging format just to visualize what's going on. So here we did a set of four occultations. These are just different revs. It's just a measure of the Cassini orbit around the planet. So this was on orbits 8, 9, 10, and 12. Back in 2005, here is the B ring, here's the A ring, here's the Cassini division. The rings were almost edge on in this geometry. And this track shows how the star moved behind the rings, due, of course, to the orbital motion of the spacecraft around the planet. That's what's causing the star to appear to move, is the orbital motion of the spacecraft. And bright yellow is the brightness of the star when it's not behind the rings. It's full regular brightness, and then black means no signal at all. So here you see the A ring was almost opaque, except for a little Encke gap here where some light came through, but it's almost opaque. Then we go into the Cassini division, it's almost transparent. We go into the B ring where it really is opaque. Back in the Cassini division, I'm back across the A ring, but you notice that the A ring here is a lot less opaque than it is there. And here we did it again on Rev 9, and this one didn't make it to the Cassini division, it just went across the A ring. But here you see the Encke gap, the outer part of the A ring looking pretty opaque, getting less opaque as we get towards the middle, and then as we come back out through the A ring, through the same radii that we were crossing here, but it's much more transparent. And then you see even the same thing here. So this turns out to be due to something that we... Okay, so here's a plot from that Rev 9 observation. Black, here's the wiggly line version. Here's the transmission through the A ring as a function of radius. Here's the ingress, here's the star coming in. The transmission is around 2% in the middle A ring. And then we turn around and come out through the same radii and the transmission is 8%. So the ring is four times more transparent on egress than it is on ingress. That means we're only about 30 degrees of longitude away in the ring, and it's quite different. And originally this was supposed to be a movie, but I apologize, the movie doesn't want to work on the computer here. But here are a set of stills from similar movies. It had been discovered by this time by people like Heikki Salo in Finland and others that if you did numerical simulations of the rings, including self-gravity between the ring particles and collisional mechanics, you didn't just get a random mess. The gravity kept trying to organize the ring particles into clumps, but then the Kepler shear, the fact that particles closer to Saturn want to travel faster than particles further from Saturn, kept stretching these clumps out. So what you get is a set of these long, strikey periods, and each of these is a little postage stamp of a little region just a couple of kilometers in size in the ring, so a tiny little image. And this kind of streaky structure is ubiquitous, but it gets stronger as you get near the outer edge of the A-ring, near the Roche limit, where gravity is getting strong enough that the particles can almost clump together and form a satellite, but not quite. And it turns out that it's for the fact that we're looking at these streaky structures from different directions that's what's responsible. And here was a simple geometric model we made. So here's just a representation of two of these streaky features, and we just approximated them as elliptical cylinders with a gap in between. And in terms of this angle B, the incidence angle of the starlight above the rings, and this important angle theta, in other words, our look direction relative to the direction of these streaky wake structures, you can easily actually write down a formula for what the transmission through the ring is. And it turns out it depends mostly on the thickness of these little structures in the rings, which we call self-gravity wakes, the ratio of that to their wavelength, the spacing between them. And it turns out that if you fit that data we get in the Cassini observations, we deduce that this ratio h over lambda is about 0.1. And we have a good theoretical reason to believe that this wavelength is about 100 meters. That's the characteristic gravitational, it's the scale in which gravitational instability first sets in the rings. And it's gravity that's making these clumps. So this is a theoretical number. We haven't observed this yet. We don't have images with 100 meter resolution or better. But assuming this is true, so the conclusion of this is that the rings are only between 5 and 10 meters full thickness, a typical scale height of only about 5 meters. So we suspected already that they were pretty thin, and Voyager told us they were no more than 100 meters thick. But 100 meters is a lot bigger than 10 meters. So really, they're a bit bigger than the height of this room, but no more than the height of this building. But about 300,000 kilometers, about one light second in diameter. So this is an incredibly flat, thin system. I want to go on and show you a couple of other features in the rings that we've seen in the occultation data or understood better. Something that was also discovered originally by some of the teams on the Voyager spacecraft was that if you look in the outer part of the ring, so this is Cassini division in here, the B ring is off the left, this is the A ring, so it's the outermost part of the A ring. If you take a higher resolution image of this region, you see these funny looking striations across the rings, and the radial direction is going out like that. So these are basically azimuthal features in the rings. This again is an image of the dark side of the rings. So probably these blacker regions are regions where the ring is more opaque, where it's blocking more of the sunlight. It turns out that each of these things are referred to as density waves, and each one is associated with an orbital resonance with one of the satellites of Saturn. So they're in fact driven by these resonances, and then they propagate outwards in the ring from the resonance. So this big one here is generated by the, the 5-6 orbital resonance with Janus. In other words, at this point in the rings, just off the left edge where the wave is generated, the orbital period of a ring particle is exactly 5/6 of the orbital period of Janus, which is about 15 hours. This one, these are two are generated by somewhat smaller satellites, so the waves are weaker. This is the 12-13 resonance with Pandora. This is the 18-19 resonance with Prometheus. And there are literally hundreds of these in the rings, and one of the things Matt Tiscarino has worked on is making catalogs of these resonances through here, and I'm not sure what the total number he's up to, but it's definitely in the hundreds, right, Matt? So these waves are useful. In the A ring, the wavelength of these waves, once you've identified the resonance responsible, the wavelength depends on the mass density in the rings, the number of grams per square centimeter in the ring. So this was used originally with Voyager observations, but much more with Cassini to make maps of the mass density across the ring. So we know that in the middle of the A ring, for example, the mass density is about 40 grams per square centimeter, or about 400 kilograms for a 1 square meter chunk of ring. So imagine that a 1 square meter chunk of ring, if you compressed it all down and measured the stuff, there'd be about a half a ton of material, about 400 kilograms, so a significant amount. So these density waves are useful for various things. You can see them very nicely in the occultations as well. So this is just a sample. Each panel is 500 kilometers, so there's 500 and then another 500, so 2,000 kilometers altogether in the outer A ring. And each of these wiggly looking patterns that you see here, not this one, but all the others, are density waves driven in the rings. And in each case, the little dotted line indicates where the resonant location is. So this is a Janus 11-9 resonance, for example. Here's the resonance, and then here's the wave. Here's a stronger one. Here's a 14-13, and here's a wave. This one is unusual. This actually is a vertical wave in the ring rather than a density wave. But I won't talk more about these here. But you should ask Jack Lissauer if you want to know more about bending waves. What I wanted to show you is some of these strange features most in the C ring. So most of these waves that we've identified are out here in the A ring, and it's not too surprising because most of the small satellites responsible orbit in this region just outside of the A ring. So most of their resonances pile up in the outer A ring. There are almost no satellite resonances in the C ring. We're too far from the satellites. But it turns out that if you look closely at occultation profiles like this of the C ring, you see these funny spikes. And then if you blow up these spikes, you begin to see that actually the spikes are little multiple spikes. And if you blow up this one even more, you can see that it's a nice looking wave. It looks rather like the ones in the A ring, but the wavelength is quite a bit shorter. And you might note that they are propagating inwards. Their wavelength is getting shorter and they damp inwards, whereas the ones I showed you in the A ring moved outwards and damped. So what that tells us is that if these are density waves driven by something, they must be driven by something that is actually orbiting or moving faster than the local Keplerian rate of the ring particles. In the case of the satellite waves in the A ring, the satellites move more slowly than the ring particles do. Their Keplerian speeds are slower, and the waves propagate outwards. So these propagate in, so they must be driven by something faster. If we compare the same wave seen in two occultations, or in this case, this is an occultation that was one of these ingress-egress ones that went into the rings, turned around, and came back out. So the same occultation gave us two profiles of the rings only a couple of hours apart. And that's what the white and purple show, the ingress and egress. And you can see the same wave structure is there, but the peaks have moved between the two. So that tells you that this is not a set of axisymmetric features in the rings. It actually is a spiral structure. The radius of the peaks changes as you go around the ring. So this confirmed for us that we were probably looking at these density waves. And I should have mentioned before that these density waves In structure, they look like a series of parallel dense regions in the rings. What we know in reality is that they are very tightly wrapped spiral patterns in the rings. So a 5 to 6 density wave is a 6-armed spiral pattern. But they're so tightly wrapped that when you just look at one little snapshot of a wave, it just looks like a set of axisymmetric things. But really, it's a spiral if you could stand back and look at the whole thing. So this tends to confirm that these are spirals as well. And to make a whole talk down to 3 slides for this particular case, it turns out that the features, that the things that might be rotating faster than the rings that might generate these, had already been identified back in the early 90s by Mark Marley and Carolyn Porco at the University of Arizona. And they said, well, these might be oscillations inside Saturn itself. And these are a set of standard oscillations. And this is true for stars, it's true for the Earth, and probably true for Saturn, that if you do something to kick the interior of a self-gravitating body, it will have all sorts of natural modes of oscillation. Now, some of them, like this one, aren't very interesting, where the whole planet just expands and contracts together. So what these are supposed to indicate to you is the dark and the light indicates parts of the surface of the planet that are rising and falling. But half an orbit period later, the part that was rising is then falling, and the part that was falling is rising. So the planet is oscillating up and down. But this indicates the geometry of these patterns. And patterns like this, so-called M equals zero patterns or axisymmetric patterns, in other words, the perturbation in the planet changes as a function of latitude from the North Pole to the South Pole, but not as a function of longitude. So even when the planet rotates, this is not going to do anything to the rings because nothing is going to change as far as the rings are concerned. But modes like this that don't vary much with latitude but do vary with longitude, so this one has 4 maxima and 4 minima as a function of longitude. So as this one, the mode both rotates around the planet intrinsically and then the planet itself rotates and carries the mode even faster. So this will produce a periodic gravitational signature that the ring particles will feel. And in fact, it turns out that the rate that these rotate is significantly faster when you take into account the planet rotation too, significantly faster than the Keplerian orbital speeds, even in the C ring. So in fact, these do have resonances in the right place. And it turns out that here's back to a sort of summary occultation plot. So each of these little spikes that has a label was one of these waves when you blew it up. So this one turns out to be due to a four-lobed pattern rotating in Saturn. These 3 close together, which is the example I showed you before, turn out to be all due to 3-lobed patterns rotating at slightly different rates. And there's one here and one over here, which are rather far apart, but both of these turn out to be due to a 2-lobed pattern. So each of these are oscillations inside the planet. We know the symmetry of the oscillations. We now know the periods of the oscillations very well because the periods determine where the resonances fall in the ring. What we don't know yet is how to really play this game backwards, how to interpret these periods in terms of new knowledge about the interior of Saturn. But this is encoding in it information about whether the planet has a core, what the interior rotation of the planet is doing, other subtleties about basically the density distribution inside the planet. This same sort of trick has been done for more than 30 years for the Sun. It's a subject that's called helioseismology. There they've discovered and analyzed thousands of these different modes, and they've learned all sorts of detailed information about profiles of density and rotation inside the Sun. So in the hope that we will learn something about Saturn, but we haven't yet, we're calling this chronoseismology. But basically, we're using the rings as a seismograph. So one more little thing to do with density waves. We've talked about waves in the A ring due to satellites, a few waves in the C ring, which appear to be due to these internal oscillations in the planet. But the B ring, the part that's in the middle, so this is a plot now, the optical depth of the B ring. In the inner part, it's not too bad. It's about between 1 and 1.5. But then in the middle part of the B ring, the optical depth goes up. A lot of this is noise, some of it's real. But the optical depths get up to 3 or 4, and even in excess of 5 in the core of the B ring. And then it drops down again to about 3 in the outer B ring, and then we have the Cassini division, and the A ring is off over here where the SETI sign is. So up until a couple of years ago, only 2 waves had been identified in the B ring. There's a nice density wave here in the inner part, the Janus 2-to-1. That was actually found in Voyager data. And there's a bending wave, a MIMAS 4-to-2 bending wave, which was dear to Jack's heart at one point in the past. This was also seen in Voyager. This was seen in occultation data. This was seen in Voyager images. But in this middle part of the B ring, no waves had been identified, mostly because the ring was too opaque and to see in the occultations, and in the images is just too much structure. It's just too complicated. So here's an example of that. This is this region here where the MIMAS 5-2 resonance, in other words, where ring particles should be moving around at a rate with a period that's 2/5 that of MIMAS. MIMAS has a period of about 1 day. And here's a blow-up of an occultation profile of this region. And you can see there's a lot of stuff going on, but it doesn't look like an obvious wave. But it turns out, through the magic of wavelets, and those of you that have played with wavelet transformers will know what I'm talking about, and there's not a lot of time to go into a background to this, but basically this is a way of doing a local Fourier transform in the ring, and it's good for tracing signals whose frequency gradually change with position. So it's a very localized Fourier transform. So when you do a wavelet transform, instead of just getting a spectrum, you get a spectrum here. So this is wave number, or 2 pi over wavelength, versus radius in the ring. So a vertical line here is telling you the power spectrum of what's in the rings at this particular radius, give or take a few tens of kilometers. And it turns out if you can't even see these waves in a single wavelet transform, but if you use a whole bunch of occultations, and we used about 16 here, and you know the rate at which the wave is rotating, because in this case we know that it should be driven by MIMAS, so we know which rate MIMAS rotates, so we know the rate at which the spiral rotates, and we know that this particular spiral is a three-lobed, three-armed spiral. So using that information, you can phase correct the individual wavelets and then stack them all up together. And if you do that, finally, you get a nice signature where you see a nice signal and the wave number is increasing as you go outward in the ring. And this is the signature of a density wave. That means the resonance is about here, where this line extrapolates to zero. This increasing wave number or decreasing wavelength is simply the wavelength getting shorter as you get away from the wave, like we've seen before. So it turned out that all but one of these features we were able to identify. I think this one we did not find, but we found this one, this one, this one, and this one. We were able to identify using this technique, and that let us actually measure the mass density of the rings. This is in grams per square centimeter on a log scale. So here's the A ring coming in at around 35 or 40 in the middle. Cassini division is down between sort of 1 and 5. These are from the waves in the C ring, basically between about 1 and 10 with a bit of scatter, and these are the B ring ones. And there had been some thought that the B ring, since it's so much more opaque, as much as 10 times more opaque than the A ring, might be as much as 10 times higher in mass density. So there'd been some predictions that rather than 40, this might be 400 in here. It turns out it's not nearly so high. All these numbers except this one are under 100, and the average of these is around 70. So a puzzle is that the B ring is only about less than twice as dense in terms of mass per unit area as the A ring, despite the fact that its optical depth is almost a factor of 10 higher in the middle. That's still a puzzle at the moment. It obviously says there's something different about the distribution of sizes and or densities of particles in the A and B ring, and the B ring doesn't get its extremely high optical depth simply by piling 10 times more stuff in there. The stuff is more efficiently distributed so that it blocks light better. For example, the particles may actually be smaller in the B ring on average than in the A ring. That would do this, because most of the mass is in the biggest particles. Skip this one. So, almost at the end here of these. So I want to show you something else we've been able to learn from putting together many of these occultations. An advantage of Cassini, I said one advantage is that you're close to the rings, so the rings fill a big area of sky, so occultations are easier to organize. In fact, there are more occultations happen than we can possibly observe with the spacecraft. We'd be spending all of our time doing occultations if we tried to do every one that we could. But in reality, we can do 2 or 3 every orbit of the spacecraft as long as we're on inclined orbits. The spacecraft did spend a lot of time flying around in Saturn's equatorial plane to study the icy satellites, which wasn't a very good geometry for occultations. So unfortunately, we have gaps of many months or even a year or more in a few places where we don't have any occultations. But we've done over 150 stellar occultations and about 30 radio occultations over the course of the mission. 150 with VIMS, the UVIS instrument has done another 100 or 150. So we've done over 300, I think, altogether. And that lets you study variability of features. Once you get many, many occultations, you can start plotting them up versus longitude and looking at variable features. So this is, we've talked a bit about the A ring, we've talked about the C ring and the B ring, and now this is a little bit about the Cassini division. So here's the outer edge of the B ring. This is the Cassini division, traditionally designated, and then the A ring starts here. Starts out here and moves on outwards. So this region is the Cassini division, and it's not a single nice hole in the rings. You can see there's lots of stuff in here, but there are gaps. So this is a gap called the Huygens gap, and there's another one here called the Herschel gap, the Russell gap, Jeffries, a very narrow Kuiper gap, and then the Laplace gap. And you can see that some of these gaps, namely this one, the Herschel gap, and this one, have little ringlets that live inside them. So the structure is quite complicated. So here is an occultation profile. Again, this one converted to optical depth. So apologize for the direction. This one radius increases to the right, and the previous one radius increased to the left. Here's the edge of the B ring. Here's the Huygens gap, that first one you saw in the image with the Huygens ringlet, the Herschel gap with its ringlet, the Russell gap, the Jeffries gap, the tiny little. This one is only 3 kilometers wide. Laplace gap, Barnard gap, and then eventually the A ring starts over here. So it turns out that once we got many occultations like this, we could measure the radii of these edges. And you can see that most of these ringlets and gaps have quite sharp edges. In fact, you can blow them up, and down at the couple hundred meter level, most of them are still sharp. You can identify the edge quite well. All of them are sharp at the 1 kilometer level. So this was a summary plot that Matt Hedman, who's worked with me on all of this data, put together. So this is a profile, again, optical depth across the Cassini division. So Huygens gap, Herschel gap, Laplace gap. It's in white. But now what we've identified in green are those edges that, when we looked at them and measured their radius, turned out not to be circular, but they're eccentric, just like the Uranian epsilon ring was, but not as eccentric as that ring was. So this is, for example, the inner edge here of the Herschel gap is eccentric. And the amplitude is 8 kilometers. So that means the radius of the edge varies by plus or minus 8 kilometers. So it goes from minus 8 to plus 8 relative to 0, which is the mean radius. So each of these little dots, data points with an error bar, is a measurement from an occultation of this edge. This one over here, the inner edge of the Jeffries gap, is eccentric, but the amplitude is only plus or minus 4 kilometers. Each of these green ones is eccentric, but we're just showing three of them here. So the inner edge here of the Bessel gap is also eccentric. This one's only 2 kilometers. Some of these features are measurably eccentric, but the eccentricity is less than a kilometer. This one is about the biggest. Turns out this ringlet here also, this is the Huygens ringlet. It's marked in green because it's also eccentric. And here's what it looks like. Again, each X, we don't have error bars here, but you can tell from the scatter what the sort of measurement errors typically are. So each measurement now is from an occultation, either a stellar or a radio occultation. Previous one just had VIMS stellar occultations, and there weren't so many. At this point, this was work done with Dick French at Wellesley College, and we've now made a big catalog of all of the occultation measurements. So now there's 200 or 250 measurements in this catalog for each feature. And now you can see this nice eccentricity, the variable width of the inner edge and the outer edge of the Huygens ringlet. This ring is about 18 kilometers wide, but its amplitude is 28 kilometers. In this case, both edges have essentially the same eccentricity. So the width, unlike the epsilon ring, the width really doesn't vary very much with longitude. We can also measure very accurately the weight at which the ring precesses, because an eccentric ring sitting around an oblate planet does not just sit there at a fixed orientation. You know, in a Keplerian model with a point sun at the middle, an ellipse would just sit there. But with an oblate planet in the middle, the ellipse precesses around slowly because of the quadrupole terms in the gravity field, the fact that the planet is flattened in the middle. So the gravity field makes the ring precess, and one of the side benefits of discovering that the Uranian ring was eccentric was that we were able to measure the precession rate of the ring. So I did that as part of my thesis. That's only about 1.3 degrees per day for the epsilon ring. For the Huygens ring, it's quite a bit faster. It's 5 degrees per day, but we know it quite accurately. We know it to about 4 decimal places. This turns out to be very useful information for the gravity field of the planet as a whole. You can get this by tracking spacecraft, but you can also get it very accurately from these rings. So it's a side benefit of this. But it turns out that when we look closely at some of these rings, Let me show you. This one is what's called a strange ringlet. And this plot actually shows why it's strange. What it actually is this little thing here. It's very sharp. So it's in the same gap. It's in the Huygens gap. But this is the Huygens ringlet we just looked at. This is the thing I'm calling the strange ringlet. It turns out it's only a bit more than a kilometer wide. And it turns out it is eccentric. So this plot shows the variation in radius of the ring as a function of angle around the ellipse. So it's in plus or minus about 8 kilometers as well. That's not so unusual. But it turns out it has a bunch of other modes of oscillation. So it also varies in radius, not just with a single maximum and one minimum per orbit like an ellipse, but this is a pattern in which there are 2 maxima and 2 minima around each orbit. This is another one, a slightly different frequency. This one has 3 maxima and 3 minima around the ring. This has 5 maxima and 5 minima. And the amplitudes are a bit smaller, but not insignificant. So this is about 3 kilometers. This is about 2 kilometers. This is about 2 kilometers. This is about 1 kilometer. This one is the strangest of all. This is M equals zero. This is a mode where this ring remains circular, but actually oscillates in radius. So this ring has a whole bunch of modes of oscillation. So but most people find the zero one the strangest one. You don't think of a ring just sitting there. It's like it's breathing in and out. Individual ring particles are traveling on nice little elliptical orbits. Kepler still wins in the end. All of these modes can be described as ring particles individually moving on elliptical orbits, but very carefully phased. So think of a bunch of cheerleaders holding up placards in a football stadium, spelling out Stanford or Caltech or MIT in the stands. Each cheerleader is just holding up a white card or a red card at the right time and putting it down at the right time. But you put them all together, you get a pattern, and if you put them all together with the right time sequence, you can actually have a pattern like a wave, move around the football stadium. And it's all the phasing of what you do to the individuals. So this is all in the phasing of what the individual ring particles are doing. It's very strange. It was predicted theoretically before it was seen, but we see it in abundance in the rings now. And one final ringlet picture, because this one is so nice I couldn't avoid putting it in. This combines two of the things we've already talked about, narrow ringlets, the Uranian rings and at Saturn. This is the Maxwell ringlet. It's a narrow ringlet that lives in a gap now in the C ring of Saturn. So here's the ringlet itself, and here's the signal, here's the gap that it's in, and the ringlet is fairly opaque, but not completely opaque. It varies in width. These are two different profiles from the same occultation. So like the epsilon ring, it changes width as it goes around. In fact, this ring looks very much like the Uranian epsilon ring, but it actually has this pattern inside it. So this is a ring that actually has a density wave inside the ringlet. So the wavelength here, this is in thousands of kilometers, so this is 20 kilometers across. So the wavelength is about 5 kilometers. And the wavelength gets shorter to the inwards, and the wave damps to the inwards. That means it's one of these internal waves. It's driven by something faster than the ringlet. It turns out this is another one of these oscillations inside Saturn that's driving this wave. Why the wave is sitting right on top of this ringlet when it could be anywhere else in the C ring it wanted to be is a puzzle. It certainly makes people think, well, maybe this is not an accident, that somehow the ringlet is there because the wave is there, because the resonance is there. But at the moment, there's no theory that says why waves in the rings driven by the planet should result in the formation of narrow ringlets and gaps. So there's some dots to be filled in here. But the wave is beautiful. It was published just last year by Dick French. So this is a movie made that tries to show you what this wave would look like if you were to do a time lapse of this. So again, like for the epsilon ring, we've exaggerated the width of the ring. So you can see the varying width of the ring from the widest to the narrowest. But it's in relative scale, it's correct. And of course, in reality, it would be slowly precessing around because of the planet's gravity field. And we've frozen that. But now you see the wave being generated. And the resonance is out about here. And then the wave is just gradually propagating inwards, and then it damps before it gets to the inner edge of the ring. So this is, we think, what this would really look like. This is a two-armed spiral, if you unwrapped it, we know from the rate at which it goes around. I see Jack looking puzzled here. He doesn't believe this. So last little thing I had to show you was, with all of the number of occultations we've done, you get a whole diversity of geometry. So some of them are nice simple ones where you start at the outside edge of the ring and the star just goes all the way across behind the rings and you get a nice complete radial profile from the A ring into the C ring. But other times you get things like this. The spacecraft orbit is such that the star just moves across and just nicks part of the ring. But so this was two examples, the same star on two different revs, Gamma Crucis, and this is the A ring. This is the Encke gap here. This is the Cassini division and the B ring. So this one went across the A ring, but didn't get in as far as the Cassini division. But it took it hours to go across here. So you can guess that when we got near the minimum radius, the star was moving very slowly, at least in the radial direction. It was still moving azimuthally along the rings at kilometers per second. But radially, it moved, so it was only moving at meters per second in the radial direction, whereas normally a typical stellar occultation, even from a spacecraft, the velocities are about 10 kilometers per second that you're talking about. So that means a 20 millisecond sample that Cassini might take in an occultation is about 20 meters in radius. But in this case, we're talking about samples that are only a few centimeters apart because the velocity was so slow. So this is what you see if you look at these occultations right close to the minimum radius. So this is just the signal from the star at 1 micron, the ends. And this is plotted now in terms of radius, but radius where 0 is the minimum radius point on that line. So this is the so-called turnaround point. And the black and green, again, indicate the ingress and egress. So this is the coming in and going out of the same occultation. This is the Rev 104 occultation. And what you see is this very nice-looking wave-like pattern. But this is 2 kilometers here, and you count them up, there's 10 peaks here. So the wavelength is only about 200 meters. This is much shorter than any of the other density waves that I've shown you, and shorter than you can normally resolve. The standard 20 millisecond sampling, I misspoke a minute ago, at 10 kilometers per second is about 200 meters in the rings. So it's rare that we get occultations that have sampling more frequent than once every 200 meters, and usually it's more like 500 meters or so. Here, the whole wavelength is only 200 meters, but now the samples are literally centimeters apart in radius because if the azimuthal direction is this way and the radial direction was this way on the rings, then the star is walking along like this almost perfectly in the longitudinal direction. So I'm only very slowly moving in or out. So that's what you're seeing here. But the nice thing is that you can see that the green pattern and the black pattern, at least out to here, overlap on top of one another almost perfectly. And if you calculate the geometry of this, even though this is only about 2 or 3 kilometers in radius from the turnaround point, if you work out on this plot here, it shows you the time in seconds along the track. So this 2 or 3 kilometers turns out to be about 100 seconds away from the minimum point. And in 100 seconds, you travel over 1,000 kilometers in the azimuthal direction. So these patterns are coherent over 2 or 3 kilometers in radius, but over a plus or minus 1,500 or something like 3,000 kilometers longitudinally. So imagine what you're looking at. Imagine you're driving down the 101 freeway. You're seeing patterns like this that are regular, that are 200 meters apart. And I could travel 3,000 kilometers down this freeway in a perfectly straight line, and those exact same patterns would continue coherently for that whole distance. And that would be okay if Caltrans had been out there painting yellow lines on the road. You might believe that. But that nature would do this is kind of amazing. So you see this on both of these occultations, although that one is the best plot. This is an attempt to sort of measure what the coherence is of these two, the ingress and egress occultations on the two occultations, Rev 104 occultation that I just showed you and the similar Rev 106 one. In both cases, you go out to between 2,500 and 3,000 kilometers before the coherence starts to fall apart. The black and the green curves don't lie on top of one another anymore. So this coherence distance of a couple of thousand kilometers seems to be common. We don't know what this is. The best guess is that it's what's called a viscous overstability in the rings. There's a theoretical model that says with the right kind of collisional interaction between the rings, a small wiggle in density can spontaneously build up until it becomes a finite amplitude oscillation that's basically self-sustaining. These patterns exist in numerical simulations of the rings. Once you start putting tens of thousands of particles in them, you see them forming spontaneously. The individual patterns only last for a few days at the most, maybe several orbits. But so they gradually evolve and change. They're not permanent. Carl and I went to the Exploratorium up in San Francisco a few weeks ago, and they had some very similar looking patterns with circular beads in a table that you could shake a horizontal table, and the beads would spontaneously form into these nice patterns. And there it's because the beads were all the same size and they formed hexagonal closest packing. And the rings are probably not doing that, but something in the collisional properties of the rings allows them to develop these structures. So I think that's what I wanted to say here. So I'll leave this for questions, but that was all the stuff that I wanted to show you today. So thank you very much for your patience.
All right, a few questions.
How many shepherding moonlets were you able to discover, were you folks able to discover that may be helpful in maintaining these gaps?
Not nearly as many as we had hoped for. Matt is a bit more of an expert on this than I, but in the end, Cassini only found one. Voyager had found one. Actually, Mark Showalter was the discoverer of this after the fact in Voyager images. So he discovered Pan. Cassini discovered Daphnis soon after it arrived at Saturn. And those happened to live in the two gaps in the outer part of the A-ring, the Encke gap and the Keeler gap. Interestingly, none of the gaps closer to the planet in either the Cassini division or the C-ring turn out to have shepherds in them that we've seen. And the upper limits are now down at the sort of 100-meter size. In other words, anything bigger than 100 meters or so, we should have seen in the images. And that's getting to be far too small. Theoretically, we expected kilometer-sized shepherds. So it looks like there needs to be something else to explain most of these gaps, not shepherds.
The ring system is this gigantic target, I would think, for rogue asteroids going through it. And I was wondering if anyone's figured out what it might look like and keeping an eye out for those signatures.
Matt, you want to say something? Yeah? Just so happens.
Yes, we have seen impact ejecta clouds in the rings, and we are actually going to look for them again in one of these the close-up orbits where Cassini is going to pass through the planet's shadow, because the ejecta clouds are made out of dust and most of the rings aren't. They get much brighter in these high phase geometries. So we have seen them. They do tell us some things about the population of meter-sized objects that are flying through the outer solar system, which
we did spend some time earlier in the mission for about a year or so deliberately looking for the impacts themselves. There was a thought that if we looked in the ultraviolet, we'd see the flash, the high-temperature flash of the actual impact. We never saw one of those. It was a long shot. But then Matt, in the end, hit upon the much more practical thing, which is to look in high-resolution images and look for the clouds after the impact has occurred. And they hang around for hours or so afterwards, so statistically you stand a much better chance of seeing them. So that's what we've seen. But collisions must be quite frequent, and there is a dust detector on Cassini, and one of the things it's trying to do is measure that dust flux. And the expectation is that on a evolutionary time scale, hundreds of millions of years, those collisions do a significant damage, is one word to put it, to the rings. They modify the rings. They do modify the shapes of some of these profiles and edges. So there is a process called ballistic transport that's basically, the key thing is that you hit it with projectiles coming in from interplanetary space, and that throws material around in the rings and redistributes some angular momentum and particle material. And that probably does cause some limited, at least, long-term evolution of the rings.
Have you been lucky enough to occult a spoke, one of these mysterious radial things?
So that's a question I don't think I can quite answer. One problem is that the spokes, many of you may remember the spokes, which were much more apparent in the Voyager images than in Cassini, but they were these ghostly looking, roughly radial features that were seen in the B-ring. And it turns out that they are mostly seen when the sun angle is very low on the rings, which it was when Voyager flew by and was not when Cassini got there. But when the sun angle got lower, as it did around 2009, we started to see these spokes in the Cassini images. But the individual spokes don't last for more than about one orbit around the planet. So in 10 hours or so, they're gone. So it's really hard to make an ongoing catalog of where they are. We only look for them occasionally. And there doesn't exist any catalog of these things that you could go back and match up an occultation and say, well, we think we went behind a spoke here. So there was a few other weird things. These two satellites, these two shepherds I mentioned in the Keeler and Encke gaps, those we have orbits for. So we have tried to look for occultations that go very close to where those shepherds are, and we have a couple. But spokes, I think we just don't know enough about the spokes to do that.
Thank you. I have so many questions, but I'll stick to one. There, in edge-on photos from Cassini, there's the shadows of those. They're not quite moonlets, but they're like maybe 100 meters high, you know, shadowing over the rings.
Yep.
And you said that the typical thickness of a ring is about 10 meters or less.
Yes.
And so these are huge. They're like, you know, office buildings flying around in you know, maybe truck-sized zone, right? So how did they get there? Why aren't they moons? Why aren't they rings? What's the deal?
So those images were actually pretty shocking when they came down. And as you say, you only see them when the sun is illuminating the rings almost edge on, and then suddenly shadows pop out that you didn't suspect were there. So what I said, I think, is true, that the average, if you go somewhere in the middle of the rings and were to go through with a meter rule and measure it, it's only about 10 meters thick. But in limited places, there are bigger structures. And in particular, at the edges of some of the gaps, so the outer edge of the B ring, the inner edge of the Cassini division, has these structures that are about a kilometer high that you can see casting shadows across the rings. And they're quite irregular looking. They're referred to as the B-ring mountains informally, because in profile it looks like a mountain chain casting shadows. But it's right at the very edge of the B-ring. And again, on the Keeler gap, which is a narrow gap I didn't really talk much about here, but in the very outer part of the A-ring, it's only about 40 kilometers wide. That's where Daphnis, one of these little shepherds, lives. And the edge of that gap also has these kind of mountain structures, but they're a bit more organized. They're kind of more periodic looking. But you can see them casting shadows too. And those are also of order, I think, about a kilometer high, from measured from the shadow length. But it's very limited. Probably, yes. We only see one side in the image. Both of those are probably produced by local strong gravitational perturbations in the rings. In the Keeler gap, it's probably Daphnis itself that's on a slightly inclined orbit and is tugging the ring particles. What does the ones at the B-ring edge is not so clear, but there's other evidence that there may be some tiny moonlets near that edge that we've never captured in an image, maybe only 100 meter size, that are doing this. The other thing is there is a single image in the B-ring away from the edge that seems to show a single object, which is what you might be thinking of, that's casting a shadow. And that's a couple of hundred meters in size. And it was initially trumpeted as an example, okay, we found one giant ring particle in the rings, and it's actually 100 meters. But a bit more thought said a ring particle that big would have disturbed the orbits of the nearby rings, and there's no sign of any disturbance around it. Even though you can see the shadow, the object is clearly there. And I think the more popular guess now is that this might have been one of these impact clouds that we caught. The spherical thing may actually be an exploding cloud of debris that has almost no mass. It's just fragments that have come off, and just by chance, you know, an impact happened very shortly before that image was taken. I'm not sure if that's the most popular theory, but that one, at least, that fits better to me.
Or it could be that was actually, it was the disturbance that was casting the shadow.
Yeah, the other possibility is that there is something even smaller there, and what you're seeing is the disturbance in the ring that it produced, which in turn is casting the shadow. So unfortunately, it was one of these one-off things. It's in a single image. You can never repeat it again, so it's we're left scratching our heads over that one. But with those couple of exceptions, the rings appear to be extremely flat, almost no thickness.
Okay. I think this will be our final question.
Yeah, hello. Yeah, very interesting, all the details about the universe. Yeah, very good, but my question, I thought then you can tell us where the UFO guys are living.
Oh, Well, that is the third possibility for this object in the outer B ring, is that this is a large globule, you know, protecting and enclosing a small spacecraft that's sitting there. So that is, of course, the other possibility. But the infamous ring makers of Saturn that were supposed to be living in Saturn's rings and parking large space vehicles there have unfortunately not emerged in, or they've been censored out of all of the images. But nowadays, since all the images appear raw online within moments of when they come back, it's getting pretty hard to censor things effectively. So I think we have to give up on the giant spacecraft or space stations.
All right, well, as is our custom, I'd like to present Phil with our SETI Talks mug. Ooh. As a token of our gratitude, and let's thank Phil one more time.
For those of you who are interested, this is what Cassini will do in the next 6 months before it finally meets its demise in Saturn's atmosphere on the red orbit. So.